So just before I introduce you to Joanne, I'll give you some context around the reason why Hayes became involved with Teen-Turn. In 2014, we decided to create a report around participation rates of women in technology within Ireland. So I was working with a colleague at the time, Susan Hogan, and we were talking about skill shortages and the challenges in finding good people within the IT arena. And Susan said to me in the conversation, "Would it be interesting to take a look at the participation rates of women within the technology sector to see if there's an opportunity there to increase participation and therefore have some sort of impact on the skill shortage in the medium term?" So we went out at the time. We interviewed surveyed 700 IT professionals, female professionals, around their career in IT and the challenges they faced. And as a result, we created a report around participation rates of women in technology. And just in terms of headlines, the numbers at the time were 23% of IT professionals were female. But when we got into the more technical disciplines like software development, that became as low as 7%. And when we launched the report, we didn't just, I suppose, look at the findings of the report and the data. We tried to come up with some recommendations around how we could impact on those rates and therefore have an impact on the skill shortage. A number of those recommendations related to both role models and mentoring within technology. As a result, we got involved with Code the Dojo for Girls. We had a relationship with Neve there, who's involved with Teen-Turn. And at the start of last year, Neve and Joanne spoke to us about the initiative, which is Teen-Turn, which Joanne will talk about shortly, and what their objectives were and what they were trying to do, and they're very much aligned to what we believe was a very much an approach which would increase the number of women in IT and therefore be part of the solution to a challenge that's out there at the moment, rather than just talking about a report and numbers. So what I'm going to do today is I'll hand you across to Joanne, and she can explain to you exactly what Teen-Turn is and why it's important and how you can get involved. And then at the end, if there's any questions you have around the mechanics of how it works that we haven't covered off today, please feel free to use the chat function to log those questions, and we'll cover them off at that stage. So over to you, Joanne.
Hi, my name is Joanne Dolan, and I'm one of the co-founders of Teen-Turn. As James mentioned, I did so with Neve Scullion, who founded Coder Dojo Girls, and Neve and I worked together on several ventures before, so then we approached Hayes with this, and I'm just going to take you through briefly, no death by PowerPoint, sort of how we arrive at the formula that equals the Teen-Turnships as they are. So Teen-Turn, we'll look at the first slide here. James was speaking. There I am. Let's see. So I just want to start with corporate, it's sort of CSR and just the concept of the competitive advantage of CSR being something that's more than just a PR opportunity, and that it's a chance to actually make an opportunity to be more competitive in an industry, and that there's an advantage to, particularly with Teen-Turn, creating a talent pool from which to draw in the future. And this goes, this kind of strategic CSR that is more than PR is something that's been discussed quite a bit, and it kind of kicked off in HBR a number of years ago, and so I referred to Porter and Kramer's article and research there. Moving forward, we'll go to how we get to this social responsibility and opportunity important to competitive success. So CSR that actually has a return on the investment. So I'll bring you now to what we've already discussed, which is that there's a need for tech professionals in Ireland. There's a shortage, a skills shortage, and sort of at the same time there is a deficit of women in technology world. So we have 45,000 job openings in ICT that are not going to be filled from the indigenous talent pool, and then we have nearly 120,000 people in Ireland in STEM related careers, and the proportion of that is less than 25% held by women, and in tech it's even lower, it's between 6 and 7% as James identified. So we don't have enough women in these roles, and we don't have enough talent to fill the role. So there's kind of an almost obvious connection, and I know Hayes really addressed that with the, you know, meeting the skill shortage by bringing more women into it. But how do you bring more women? And this is where we get into a little bit more of also what Teen-Turn's trying to do. There's a very low uptake in third-level courses from low-income areas. So it's not just that women aren't doing STEM-related courses and entering into STEM careers. There's an untapped talent pool that isn't going into third level. So the National Plan for Equality of Access to Higher Education, 2015 to 2019, has a goal to actually start bringing more individuals into third level coursework. And ideally, if it's the third level course that work that could feed into these tech jobs, then there would be a lot of wins there. So we go to Teen-Turn's objective, and we want to tackle this need for ICT professionals and the deficit of women in technology, and then bridge this divide between the corporate and the community to encourage third level progression in disadvantaged areas. In other words, a lot of these companies are located alongside communities where the residents aren't even employees of those companies. And if we could kind of sort of create our own ecosystem of talent going into third level courses, encouraging women from these areas into third level courses that are in subjects that would eventually produce sort of good candidates for these jobs, then there's a whole sort of holistic approach to solving several problems. And it's a long-term goal, but it's where we're starting. So then I have a quote from James. James is talking about how the third-level qualification career choice is vital to the industry's future success. And encouraging girls to consider tech is going to really help. So we're focusing on teen girls, and we want to influence their course decision-making processes and inform them on the education and career options before they make them, as young girls, before they're going into Leave and Cert, before they're even choosing CTEC courses or, you know, possible IT courses that would necessarily be in the traditional third-level course curriculum. So extensive research has been done by Microsoft, and they've identified that girls lose interest in STEM at age 15. Now, there's multiple reasons why they stay in, and they talk about parents' influence and mentor influence, but it's very important that they identify the age of 15 because Teen-Turn works with girls at that age group. We work with those who are in the summer after their junior cert, but before TY, before transition year, before choosing Leaving Cert subjects. And this is when we can get them, and this is when we turn them, as we say, without any sort of bad implications. They may have already done junior cert math, but they're not sure, interested, or aware. So the concept of putting them in to a tech career environment and seeing the culture and the promise and the interest and how creative and exciting it is to be in these environments, hopefully that will propel them towards further study and possible third-level course choices that would lead to careers. Where we work in particular is with a lot of the disadvantaged areas, and so we have a quote here from a school completion coordinator in Ballyfermot. Now, Ballyfermot has a 16% enrollment rate in third-level courses, so even just finishing school is a challenge, but to get them to go beyond is something that Leslie works on, and she is very much a proponent of this program, and she finds that it's a very practical experience, and it influences them and has an impact, and it actually helps them identify what it's like to visualize themselves in this kind of environment and possibly motivate them to continue. So each placement is assigned a female mentor because, as I said, it is understood that mentorship is a major influencing factor with young girls, and they participate in a technology project when they're in these internships. We're turning them towards tech, so we can't just have them go into the typical internship where they're faxing, filing, and photocopying. It has to have some kind of real exposure to a tech project, either through observing or actually hands-on experience, but it has to be, their exposure has to be there, and then they blog about their experience, and for those who, you know, immediately are worried, we do work with them and make certain that there's no disclosure and that these aren't publicly accessible blogs unless they're allowed to be. And we can talk a little bit more about that, but they participate in the project and then they blog about it. And that's the reinforced experience, because writing about it certainly, it internalizes how they've processed the information, and it creates a better impact on the participants in that way. And this is, again, learning the presence of female role models. It's been studied. It impacts girls' self-image, their confidence, and encourages them to see themselves in new ways and stimulate interest. So they're blogging about it, they're tweeting about it, and they're interacting with women who are in these tech positions, and some are very different from them, and some are not so different, but they have that kind of very positive experience of interacting with women who are their future, who could be that they could see themselves as being in the future. And it's a very good way to sort of make the girls feel comfortable, particularly in these environments, which are, as we know, male-dominated. And then Oshin from Swerve was talking about this and saying it's a great opportunity to create new female role models, and it's an opportunity that the industry will benefit from as a whole, which goes back to that CSRR that's more than just for PR. There is a return on it. Research has also indicated that teen girls have difficult grasping what a job in STEM is. So again, putting them in a career environment, not just bringing in somebody who has a career, talking to a class, or pushing them towards more courses or taster courses, but actually putting them in that job in STEM, putting them next to someone who's working in a job in STEM, there's no better way for them to better understand what it is. So they're experiencing hands-on what it is to be in a STEM job, and to even contribute to the technology they themselves use. And this is important because a lot is discussed about how little women have to, how few women work in technology, and yet so much of technology is purchased by women, and they are a formidable consumer force. That's actually, there's a Boston, a BCG, I think, did a very extensive study and found that they're probably the most powerful consumer force, actually, and yet they're not giving as much input into design as one would expect from the majority force in a consumer market. So we talk here, there's a Claudia from one of her blogs, and she's from Mount Carmel. She was born and reared in Dublin 1, just in the shadow of the IFSC, and she was brought in and was working there and never heard of data science or data analytics, and was taken through a task and found it was interesting and realized what it is to work with data, and that it's actually something that's doable, and that she herself couldn't necessarily have initially seen herself working with data as a career or even a job, but suddenly she was exposed to it and found that it was accessible. Then if you'll hold one moment.
Hi, it's James. Joanne is actually a mother of a young baby who seems to have intervened in her delivering the presentation. So
sorry, I'm back. I'm very
excellent.
I must apologize. I feel like I'm having that BBC moment where somebody rolls into the background during a Skype call. So no frantic assistance there. Apologies again. that's the hazards of working from home at times. So again, deaf schools is where we mentioned earlier, and deaf schools are very well run organizations. They're schools that are in disadvantaged areas, and they have a commitment to delivering equality of opportunity, and we work with them. And why this is so important is, aside from the fact it's a means to get into these communities with those who know them, the girls are vetted. They're chosen by those who know them best, by guidance counselors, by teachers, and by school completions officers. And these girls are identified not only their promise, but for the possibility that this could really be a beneficial opportunity. So they're not necessarily the star students who are headed to engineering at UCD anyway. These are girls who may consider other types of future courses, but if we get them now, that's the real change. So because we're not doing the interviews, because we're not speaking them out, it's a very sort of intimate and well understood relationship between the school and the students, and it also deals with a lot of the parent and guardian consent issues that may come from girls who may not be from homes where there's a parent that would be readily available for these sort of support. So by doing this, the program is well positioned to not only address gender equality in the workplace, but this economic inclusion with companies in the areas that are disadvantaged, located, you know, alongside them, and that's why we're working with DESH. And it's been very successful so far. They're really responsive to this. So this is in summation: is that more girls from areas where third level education is uncommon, exploring and gaining an interest in tech has the potential to lead to more women earning those qualifications and thus meeting the skills shortage that's currently so problematic. So we're not just bringing girls into the STEM subjects, we're also bringing girls who wouldn't even have been in third level towards these kinds of career goals. And that's, well, there's a quote here from Anna from Davy, and she's talking about how she exposed her intern to a lot of areas in order to really gain her interest, and Katie in turn proved to be extremely responsible and a hard worker, and was really engaged in the project, and actually was a very good employee for that period of time. And I think of her reference letter that she received at the end. And at the end, we always ask all of the companies to write a kind of a statement of completion letter, so the girls can have it for a reference going forward. And so again, this is the social responsibility, it's an opportunity important to competitive success. It's CSR, but it's not just for public relations. It's CSR that will hopefully produce a talent pool from which they can draw in the future. And that's where we go. And yes, there is some PR benefits, of course, and that, you know, increases visibility. There's social media, newspaper, radio, television. And what's very good, particularly for companies that like to do annual reports where they include their CSR. We have great photography and video content that would be in keeping with Kyle, with child protection. And we also provide key impact metrics, which as the cohorts progress and graduate will become more and more of a network of information. And then this is what Teen Turn offers. We provide the vetted, to use the word vetted, participants. We make sure everything's compliant with the Young Persons Act. We make sure all the hosting agreement docs are up to code, if you will. We provide an induction prior and explain rules and behavior expectations. And the companies, in turn, we hope for a female mentor, ideally, even if she's Skyping in from another location, as some companies sometimes have trouble. The smaller ones, they don't always have a female engineer on site. And the opportunity for the participant to work with a technology project. The only cost, we don't charge a fee or anything like that, the girls are not paid, but we expect that their travel and their lunch expenses are covered so that they're not paying out of experience or out of pocket for the experience. So usually this is in the form of a leaf card. If you have a canteen, then it's easier. If it's not, then vouchers or even we do a prepaid visa will work for the lunch expenses. And then, as I mentioned before, a completion statement is what we hope for at the end. And there it is.
Okay, so Duran, I've had a couple of questions. I think we may have covered some of these off already, but just for clarity, when are the teen-turnships of, and how long are they for?
Do you want to answer? Oh, I'll do the answer. They're 2 weeks long. They start at the end of July. I think it's like July 31st. If I look at the map, sorry, at the calendar. It's July 31st is the first day. August 11th is the last day. It's done so that the girls can have enough time off after their junior cert and enough time a little bit before the start of the school year again so they can have some sense they've enjoyed their holidays. We do the induction during the week of the 24th. And if it's in Cork, we're going to, hopefully if there's enough in Cork, then we'll go down and have an induction in Cork for the girls in Cork or Galway. Obviously, we're not going to make all of them get on a train and come to Dublin if there's enough to go for the induction. That's why we say that week, because there might be a Dublin day, a Cork day, and a Galway day or something like that for the inductions during the week of the 24th.
Okay, so depending on the number of the amount of interest outside of Dublin, we'll do something specific for other locations. Okay, and in terms of safety requirements, are there any special safety requirements for hosting the teen internship?
There are. In part of the hosting agreement, this is outlined that there's sort of for now, unless you're really working in a factory, there's probably not a lot to be concerned with because most of these jobs would be at computers. But there are safety concerns that you have to address, and the hosting agreement outlines sort of what you have to do. And it's really you assign an employee who says, yes, I've evaluated the space for risks and will be cognizant of young persons in employment at this facility, and my name is, and you sort of sign as the point person for health and safety during that internship. And again, the hosting agreement it spells all of this out very clearly, so that there's nothing unusual or unexpected in there. It's very much like any of the transition year work placements, really.
Okay, and what about Garda vetting? Do mentors need to be Garda vetted?
No, they don't. Garda vetting is identified as necessary for unsupervised relationships. So this is why they do not encourage sole traders to do transition year placements. But if a person is not alone in an area that cannot be seen with the mentee, then you're good to go. This again, we have it in the frequently asked questions as well as in the hosting agreement. There's a mentor statement which the person signs off on and says, no, I have no criminal record which would prevent me from working with young persons or vulnerable adults. And it clearly states the sort of parameters in which you can interact with a young person in a work environment. And it's a lot of common sense. There's nothing particularly unexpected in there, I would think, for anyone.
Okay, and I have a specific question here, which is, I've got two questions here. One is, there's an organisation in Limerick, is there, and this is probably a good opportunity to talk about just how we identify and engage with the students and the parents, full stop, but is there interest from students and schools in Limerick? And maybe we can cover broader just how you actually source, for want of a better expression, the students.
Well, what will happen is if a company has a placement for us, we will go to the geographically closest DESH school, and there are DESH schools in Limerick, and we will speak with their guidance counselor, school completion officer, and they will identify a candidate and write a reference and go through the consent and age confirmation paperwork. So it's not about students expressing an interest from an area. It's about us having a placement ready and available, and we contact the school, and the schools have more than enough candidates. It's actually getting the companies first and then to just narrowing down. I mean, sometimes it's disappointing for the school when I come to them and say, I only really have two or three placements for you, because most have many, many girls they would like to place in these opportunities.
Okay, excellent. I had the same question from Cork. I also have another question from Cork, which is, what type of projects would be required?
Any kind of project we expose under technology. I mean, we had girls working in an IT help desk. There were companies that aren't technology companies that had them visiting their distribution sites and sort of seeing how their actual factory facilities work and forklifts and keeping track of stock. So anything that exposed them to tech and the entire universe of tech is what we want them to see, other than the normal internships that you might find where you're running errands and getting coffee. We want them to see tech. And girls in particular don't take these internships up, so it's to show them any kind of projects that would be in that category, or a mix. I mean, we did have a company that had a different thing every few days, and they went around all the different departments and saw what tech is used in each department, and that kind of exposure is suitable as well if you don't have a specific project, or you know, you just don't have the staff to be able to do it.
And I have quite a specific question here, which I'm not sure if we'll be able to answer or not on the call, but it says, do we need to provide manual handling training?
I think we'd have to probably speak specifically with what it is they plan on having them do. As I said, you know, most of these internships don't involve that kind of work, but if there's laboratory work or that kind of thing, we'll talk with you about it. Obviously, they will need any training that would be required to be safe. If that means even just observing, then that's in keeping with your company's protocol. It has to be done, and that's part of it.
Okay, I think that covers off all the questions I've been asked. I'll just see if there's give it another few seconds if any other questions come online. Oh, there is one more question. Do companies typically take on one person per year or more than one? It's a very good question, actually.
We would like to have them take on two. Now, if they can only take on one, we are delighted to have any placement whatsoever. But the reason we ask for a minimum of two, if it's possible, is because these girls, they like to have a buddy, as you can imagine, and it's nicer to not be the only one walking around, particularly with these big companies. It's quite intimidating. So if they can pair off, it's very helpful, and friendships are formed that way. We found a lot of girls who didn't know each other already would have become friends from having found themselves at the same internship location.
Okay, and the question is coming in thick and fast now, which is great. We have an IT department, network engineering department, and a network operations department. Can the student move around or just keep to one department? I think the answer to that is either or, but I will get your view on it as well, Joanne.
No, absolutely, and James, you're right. And jump on in, James. You know this program as well as I do at this stage.
Next question is, how many years has the program been running for? Well, this is the second year, and in the first year, I think there was 15 teen internships, and our objective this year, and they were all within Dublin, and our objective this year, we're all working together, is to try and get that to 50 teen internships across the country. So it's quite ambitious growth plans, but with the amount of interest we have so far, we are confident that we'll achieve those numbers. So obviously, it's not the first year, and there have been lessons learned since last year, and some tweaks made to the program as a result of the feedback we got from both the hosts and the teen turns themselves. So yeah, we're in the second year, and we're hoping to grow year on year. And you know, this is not just a once-off thing. This is something we're hoping we can scale across the whole of Ireland. Despite the fact that both Joanne and myself don't have Irish accents, we've both been in the country for a very long period of time, and have
Irish
children.
Speak for yourself, James. I'm not that old.
I've got a couple more questions. One of the questions is, do we work with schools across all of Ireland? And I suppose, like this year, our objective has been to scale it beyond Dublin with a specific focus on Cork, Limerick and Galway, and anywhere that there's a deaf school, really, you know, because that's where the source of the individuals are. Obviously, you know, logistically, there are some limitations to what we can do. So our main focus this year has been Cork, Limerick, Galway and Dublin. But that's not to say if you are outside those locations, we wouldn't be interested in having a conversation. We just need to see if it's possible to source students who would be appropriate for the program. And another question we have here is, would the mentor have to be there for a full 2 weeks, or would it be okay if they're away for a few days during a placement? And again, I'll let Joanne answer this, but at a headline level, I think the answer is yes.
I'll just answer this quickly because I actually have a creature calling me. Yes, and James, I think we spoke with this. In some cases, we even had the mentor in a different location, Skyping in and that kind of thing. The mentor doesn't have to be there every day or so hands-on, if you will. It's just as long as there is one, and you know, you can have a male mentor. It's ideally that there's a female role model involved in the process, so you can share. I mean, in some companies, they didn't have one mentor. They had a team, and they all took turns spending time with the interns.
And in terms of a very good question to sort of probably close, in terms of next steps, what are the next steps for registering sort of the interest as a company and actually, you know, signing up and having more detailed conversations?
The next steps would be to advise us of how many you would like. We'll give you the hosting agreements so you can review them. They have, last year was a pilot program, and it did go through some very large legal teams at multinationals, so we're pretty confident that this isn't a challenge, of course, but they seem to have withstood Silicon Valley. So you'll read through them, and if you're happy, most of it's just really involved saying what the project is and who's the person that's the contact. You do one hosting agreement per intern, and then we will work with the school to identify as many participants as your particular company needs in the geographic area. We'll get their references and their information, and then when that's complete, we'll talk about how their first day will be with you, what you require of them, organize sort of their transportation, if they're walking, if they're taking the bus, if there's a leap card, that kind of thing. So the first step would be just to come back and confirm your interest and how many you'd be interested, you know, potentially to take on, and then we'll give you the hosting agreement and you can review that, and then that's when the paperwork's done.
So just to give you the email address, the contact email address, so everybody has that. You also probably, I believe you had the chance to express an interest when you signed up for the webinar, and obviously you may not have been in a position to do that at stage because you wanted further information, but the email address is contact@teen-turn.com. So once again, that's contact@teen-turn.com. The web address is www.teen-turn.com. And the Twitter handle, for those of you who are on Twitter, is @teen-turn. So I think that wraps up. I think we've covered off all of the questions, Joanne. Thank you very much for your time, and thanks for everybody's time who's attended today. It would be fantastic to hear from all of you expressing an interest in terms of becoming involved this year. And have a lovely afternoon. Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.